Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our discussion tonight on evangelization and apologetics. Let us begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, we gather this evening to talk about evangelization and apologetics, what these words mean to us, rooted in Jesus' words before he ascended to heaven to his disciples after his resurrection. He said, go out and baptize all nations and proclaim the gospel in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We come tonight to discuss ways to share our faith. Guide all of us. Guide those here to open their ears, to open their hearts, to hear your words. Inspire me with the words you wish them to hear, to help them all grow in faith and love. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
So, we can start with a question, why are we here tonight? Well, one of the things I can say for this is, at the end of the last couple sessions, I give you the evaluation forms to fill out, and one of the last questions always, what topics would you like to hear about? And in the past, some people have said they wanted to hear things about sharing the faith. Well, that's evangelization. And last time, somebody wrote defending the faith. Well, in part, that's apologetics. So we're talking about this tonight because people have asked for it. And when we talk about sharing the faith, often when we ask the question, there's somebody in mind that we have that we want to be able to talk with. Notice the with is italicized, and in parentheses, not to. Because sometimes we think we should just be able to, especially if you're thinking children or something, you think that you should just be able to tell them to do it, and they should do it. But in reality, we know that's not always the most productive way to get them to respond. If you just talk to them, they're not always receptive. If we talk with people, hopefully they can be a little more open. So with that, that was one of the first questions on your pre-quiz, so to speak. Is there any particular category that people are, there is somebody that you want to be able to talk to? No naming the individual, please.
You want us to raise our hands?
You can call it out.
Okay. Yeah, I have three people that I'd like to.
What types of people do I have? How do you know them?
Just neighbors.
Any others?
Co-worker.
Hmm?
A co-worker.
Co-worker. Other, any others?
Strangers.
Strangers.
Folks that are non-Catholic, mostly Protestants.
Protestant people. Yeah. So I always think of family. Maybe that's because half my family's Catholic, half's not. On both sides, a lot of them don't go to church. We can have friends that we know but just aren't churchgoers, maybe whether they fall away, never win, maybe go to a different church. Neighbors, co-workers, I always tell people with co-workers, tread lightly. We don't want you getting fired over this. Again, not forcing it with them, not talking to them, talking with them. I raised the question, how about our parish or people in our parish? You know, sometimes we assume if people are coming to church, everything's good, they believe and whatnot. And especially if they're involved, we believe. If you look at, and I mentioned this book a few weeks ago in a homily, I know you all remember every word I said about it in that homily. Forming Intentional Disciples. And in here, she actually talks about a woman they were interviewing for a study. The woman was a leader of multiple ministries in their parish, involved in many different things. And when they asked her what her relationship with God was, her answer was, I don't have a relationship with God. She had a lot of involvement, but there wasn't really spiritual base versus, I mean, she liked doing the things, she was doing good things, but it wasn't connecting the way we might assume it's connecting. So even people sometimes who are coming to church all the time need a little evangelization. Sometimes they need a lot. So we can think about our parish. And then we can also think about the whole world. There's lots of people out there that need to be evangelized. If you're unfamiliar with them, go home and watch the news. It's not too hard to find people who aren't leading good lives. I'm not necessarily talking terrible things. Unfortunately, there are those people out there too. But ultimately, the gospel, Christ, is supposed to be taken to the whole world. No one of us alone is going to take it to the whole world, but that we are all to do our part for that. And when we talk about evangelization, these are the types of things we talk about. Who are we trying to take the faith to? We can all have somebody particular in mind, but there's a bigger picture. Comments or questions? So, if we're going to share our faith, we need to be able to talk about our faith. You know, and sometimes we think about faith, we think about knowledge. And we'll get into that idea later. And the knowledge is important. We all need to learn a little more. But we need to be able to talk about who Jesus is to us. They were supposed to come up one at a time. So, on the sheet was a thing, who is Jesus to you? These words, and actually there's a couple not showing yet, I guess. Might as well show them all. on the sheet, for you to circle, or other words. Does anybody have any comments about one of these words really striking out to you, or a different word? That you think, when you think of Jesus, what fits?
Well, I don't think police officer is a very good description.
Don't think police officer is a good description. Why?
Well, because they enforce everything that's wrong, and Jesus is forgiving, so I don't think...
Mm-hmm. Jesus wants us to follow the laws, but he isn't... He doesn't exist to enforce the laws. Any other thoughts?
Dictator?
Why?
Because Jesus and the way that he deals with us is he's loving and he treats us with kindness and equality. Dictators, they just tell you what to do.
So you mean not? Fit.
Yes.
It doesn't fit, okay. and it's true, because if you just read the Old Testament in a rigid God sense, it can seem like that. Although if you read the Old Testament with open eye, you see a lot of it that God is still forgiving. But that's where some people's images come from.
I like the term transcendent one, creator, and all-powerful for God the Father. Mm-hmm. That's what I would attribute to him.
Mm-hmm. When we say transcendent, what does that mean for you?
All-encompassing, over everything. Mm-hmm.
Some people will look at it that way, kind of over everything. Some people sometimes look at it and kind of think distant one. You know, so even the same word, there's different ways of looking at it. Creator, some people might say, there are people who will talk about God in a sense that they say, well, God was some superior being who created the world and then went on his way and kind of forgot about it. Obviously, that's not our view as creator. God created the world for us and remains involved in it. How many say friend or brother?
I
do. Go ahead.
I like the last four, actually. Out of all of them, I like the last four.
A physician, heal thy soul. Friend, brother, somebody we want to be around. Savior, and there's, with Savior, we can look at Savior just as forgiving our sins. Or there can be a much deeper relationship with that there. It's not just forgiveness. That's a very important part of it. We do need that forgiveness. Other thoughts? Or other things not on our list? So, these words can be ways of us beginning to describe our faith. Obviously, if we call God dictator versus brother, that says something about our relationship with Jesus. And relationship is a term, as Catholics, we don't necessarily use much. You know, that's something evangelicals talk about. You've got to have a personal relationship with Jesus. Everyone who comes to church, no matter how connected they are to the faith, how distant, has some kind of relationship with Jesus. They may not know. And even if somebody used to go to church and doesn't, that still there's some kind of a relationship there. It can be a broken relationship. It can be one that just never was very strong. And then, but if you know about Jesus, you have some kind of interaction. You may have people have gone or don't go to church anymore, may have rejected him or whatever, but there's something. And this can be very important, be able to talk to other people, you know, to evangelize others. We must ask ourselves, how has knowing Jesus changed my life? If we're talking to somebody who already knows a lot about faith, maybe they're already past this in some way. But if you're talking to somebody who has absolutely no sense of God in their life, this might be the most important thing to be able to talk to them about it. Because you're talking to them about what it means for you. Why should they believe versus just giving them, you know, picking up. Sharing the faith is not going out and handing all your friends a copy of the catechism in the Catholic Church. If they've never been to church in their life and have no understanding of God, they pick this book up, and they're going to pick it up, and then they're going to put it back down. Because I remember when I started in seminary, we actually used this for a couple of classes, and by the start of this semester, I took it one night. Am I supposed to be able to understand this? Because maybe I need some remedial education before I begin. But now I can pick up a lot of it. Oh yeah, da-da-da-da-da. But the knowledge is important. We need to work to learn. But it can begin with just simply, how has knowing Jesus changed our lives? So, going back to the idea from the first slide, why are we here tonight? You may remember the story of the 100 sheep. 99 stay right where they're supposed to be. One goes off. This is that scripture passage. And Jesus talks about, he tells this parable, about doing anything to get that one sheep back. And when they're back, to throw a party for them, to be so happy they're back. When we think about people today not going to church, you know, Jesus talked about one going astray. The author Wendell in the book Forming Intentional Disciples, when she brings this parable up, she says, now today we're heading towards one sheep staying and 99 going astray. I don't think we're really quite there yet, but we're heading there, and we've got to do something different. And I said we, not me. Some statistics about people not going to church. I don't want to bore you with too many, but any idea? There's a study in 2008 talking about how we relate to people that showed the fastest growing religious demographic in the United States is people who mark unaffiliated on the form when they're asked whether they're Catholic, Presbyterian, what, Jew, Buddhist, whatever. The fastest growing group in 2008, and I've seen more recent things that I don't have the exact numbers for, but signify this trend is continuing. But when we say they say unaffiliated, we do need to realize that unaffiliated, when they mark the form, doesn't necessarily mean they don't believe in any way. In fact, they did a study that said 30% of people who marked unaffiliated have a congregation that they belong to and regularly worship at. And I think that says a lot for where people's attitudes are at now. If you can be regularly going to church and you're asked on some form, unaffiliated, it's like, you know, whether they're unashamed or just don't want to, you know, the idea, you know, oh, we keep the peace by, you don't talk about religion and politics. So I got, you should go, whether, do they just work unaffiliated as their way of not talking about religion? Because there's more and more people out there saying, oh, you can believe whatever you want, just don't bother me with it. So you mark unaffiliated. More to our own immediate lives, perhaps, the experience we're familiar with. They say, if you take people born baptized Catholic, only 30% are practicing their faith today. And to get to 30%, they define practicing as going once a month. If you go read that other book I was holding up called The Catechism, we're still supposed to go weekly. You know, sometimes, you know, if there's a major snowstorm, God understands. If you're sick, God understands. If you got a broken foot, and you're told, the doctor tells you, don't just use it as an excuse, but if the doctor says you need to stay put, you stay, God understands those things. But just as many people do just think going once, oh, that's good enough, or I'm doing far better than my brother or my friend, or whatever. Another 38% say they're Catholic, but seldom go. No names there, but I'm sure we can probably look, if not all of us can come up with something. And then the last 32% actually say they're not Catholic anymore. Whether they're going to a different church or just not going at all. They know, used to be a generation or two ago, even if you weren't going, if you were born Catholic, and I'm assuming it was true in Protestant, other denominations or even beyond Christianity, you would say, if somebody asked on a forum, you would say, oh, I'm Jewish and I don't go, but I'm Jewish. I'm Christian, I'm Catholic. Now people are just, not, even if they were raised in it, are just saying, oh, I'm nothing. I don't believe. So, questions? So. Question on your form, I forget how it's worded, but basically it's what is evangelization? When you hear the word evangelization, what does that mean to you?
Sharing your love of Jesus with other people.
Sharing your love of Jesus with other people. Ready? Anyone else?
Sharing the gospel.
Sharing the gospel.
Hopefully using example of what you do in your daily life to other people.
Using some examples from daily life of what you do when you're talking with people. These are good answers. Sometimes when people think of evangelization, they think of the denominations who will come knocking at your door. And not that you can't do evangelization that way, but that's not all evangelization is. Because when you think about going door to door, you don't see too many Catholics do that.
No.
Although there is a thing now, not door to door, it's a national group now. I don't know if their official name is Street Evangelization, but they'll stand like at outside stores, and they're Catholic, and they will hand out rosaries, talk with people if they're willing to talk, never force, just say, oh, would you like a rosary? If they talk, they talk. If they don't, they don't. And when I first started hearing about this, I started thinking, oh, yeah, well, you could do that in a big city, maybe, where there's lots of people, but can you do it around here? Well, then I got an email through the diocese. We have a priest, and I just couldn't say his name, because you could have seen that on TV, Father Mike Mayer, who's in Geneva as the parochial vicar. He's part of the program, and actually a couple weeks ago, he was on EWTN in a program they were doing with the national people for this, and they had him on as one of the speakers, and then in a couple weeks he's going to be on again. And they're going to places, and he told me, I was at a priest dinner Saturday night, and he told me what stores they do it at in Geneva. But they're literally standing out there at stores, handing out rosaries or do whatever. If people want to talk, they talk. If they don't.
Father, what happened to the Legion of Mary that was started years ago? And I was part of that and knocked on doors. I went into houses and we talked. We evangelized. And then it just fell apart.
I believe Legion of Mary is a group that I just had seen some mailing about a month or two ago, that they are still active in Rochester. But with numbers, just like the numbers are down in church, the numbers are down in some of these groups, so they've fallen out of practice. They still exist as an overarching thing, but they're not in the number of parishes they used to be. But there have been groups that would go. And the street evangelization idea, if it's working in Geneva, maybe it could work here. The door-to-door thing, I've had a hard time getting past the idea of these people who come knocking on your door from other denominations. I don't think I'd say they're forceful, but they're more. They're coercive. They're not. They don't necessarily beat you or whatnot, but they can be more aggressive than they should be, and that's not our intent. It doesn't mean as Catholics that we couldn't go door to door.
I was walking home from church Sunday, and two people were on my porch, and I called ahead and said, "Are you ringing my doorbell?" And they came off the porch and met me on the sidewalk. They were absolutely not forceful, not coercive. They just handed me a pamphlet and invited me to come to their church next Sunday.
And you just pointed down the street
and said,
"That's my church."
No, I did not.
She literally does live.
but I did say, well, I just came from church, but I felt no reason to tell them that I was a member here. I just came from church, and I turned around and pointed, that way, when I was up there. So. But they absolutely were not coercive, and they were very, very pleasant, polite couple, the minister and his wife, and they didn't say, will you come? And they just handed me the pamphlet.
And some of them can be very friendly. Some can be a little more.
And then the Sunday before, I came home from church, and I had a paper stuck in my doorway. Different church.
Actually, if they're leaving it on Sunday morning, maybe the response is, "I wasn't there when you knocked on my door because I was at church. When do you go to church?"
Well, this was actually about 1 o'clock, so I couldn't get into that.
Father, I bring communion. Well, I had been until I had the separation, but to people who can't make it to church anymore. And they're my age, but I have been so enlightened by their conversations and their faith. It has helped me to grow. They have beautiful stories. They can't make it to church, but we share so much. And it's so good to hear.
With some of the best evangelization that we can do, we'll grow from it ourselves. So you talk about going to people, and especially in that case, where the only reason they're not getting churches is because of their health,
right,
or whatever, doesn't allow them. Some of those can be the most people out there, so we go to evangelize them, and sometimes it comes right back in a very good way. Other comments? So, when you think about evangelization, mentioned the Legion of Mary before, you used to go door-to-door. Our church has always meant to be a church of evangelization. If you go back and read the Acts of the Apostles, it is the story of the first church after Jesus died. Chapter 1 has Jesus still there. In the beginning of chapter 2, he ascends at Pentecost. Chapter 1 he ascends, chapter 2 is Pentecost. And then the 12 apostles all start going out, spreading the faith. And then Paul gets involved. But none of them were just sitting on their laurels. They were all going out and spreading the faith. Some going short distances, some going long distances. And I'm not saying any of us should be on the road, you know, going out in that geographic sense. But if they hadn't worked to spread the faith, if they had not worked to evangelize the people, where would we be today? We would not have the faith. And we're not talking about our faith today because some people don't like it. And the more we don't talk about it, the more people that don't want to hear about it because it's just foreign to them. It doesn't fit their things. And we've got to learn ways to talk about it. Thoughts? Talk about what evangelization is not. Proselytism. It is more when you get into it is being, proselytism is being more forceful. It doesn't mean like a military force necessarily, but it is, you know, telling people either you do this or you're going to burn in hell or whatnot. And there's this quote on defending faith. Referring to Pope Francis. Pope Francis said, the church must grow by attracting, not proselytizing. Attracting. We need to go, going back to what I said, who is Jesus to us? How is Jesus? Tell people the good things about our faith and what it means for them. To show them reason why they should want to join versus telling them they must or you got to do this or... Commandments are important to follow. They're not the place to necessarily start. Somebody who has no belief or little belief. Questions?
I always think of it too as finding fault with other people's faith. When you're trying to share something about your faith, you don't necessarily want to punch holes in what their beliefs are.
Yeah. The point is not to criticize their faith. It doesn't mean if we're really educated in their faith, we might be able to help them understand, I don't know, I guess maybe it's shortfalls or something. Not to go to them and say, your faith is wrong because it says this. But here's this point. You know, yours says this, but let me tell you something more that my faith
says. Perspective or interpretation.
Mm-hmm. To meet them where they're at. And this, that will come up again in a couple slides. But this one, Pope Paul VI wrote in Evangelii. How do you people? Latin was one semester pass-fail. And it was geared towards being able to read old documents, not pronounce them. So my Latin pronunciation is awful. But he says, evangelization is in fact the grace and vocation proper to the church, her deepest identity. She, being the church, exists in order to evangelize. You know, go back. What did they do in the Acts of the Apostles? They went out and shared the faith. That is, in describing evangelization, in order to preach and teach, to be the channel of God's gifts of grace, to reconcile sinners and perpetuate Christ's sacrifice in the Mass. When he says things like reconcile sinners, realize, as a priest, there's a particular way I can do that in the sacrament of confession. But we can all help people straighten out their relationships with God, get in line, because of particularly when it comes to like misunderstandings and things like that. And I can perpetuate Christ's sacrifice in Mass. As the priest, I'm the one who presides at Mass. But we can all talk about what it is, what Mass is about for us, what our faith is for us, what the Eucharist means for us. Questions? So why evangelism? Well, we can go back to the idea of, I was saying at the beginning, we can know friends, neighbors, that either have never gone to church or are used to but don't When I say used to, don't remember, I didn't go to church for 16 years. If God's counting numbers, I may have caught up by now, I'm not sure. But in this book, which book is it? Both of the books I refer to tonight, I have, well, this is actually, you can have it back after tonight, Marge. This is one Marge lent me. But he says something that, to me, the words aren't that profound, but they're so real, they're right. Why evangelize? Because the eternal destinies, heaven or hell, of millions of our fellow Catholics, not to mention many millions of countless others, are hanging in the balance. If we do not work to evangelize, souls will be lost. And this isn't, as a Catholic priest, I have a bias towards the Catholic Church, of course, because I think it's got something right. But this isn't a judgment about Catholics and not and versus other Christian training. This is just, even just think about people who have no sense of faith, that there isn't even a God. What's going to happen to them? And the church does talk about baptism by desire, saying if they, God knows what the belief they would have if they knew about Jesus. But we got to try and tell them. So, now, what about apologetics? This was on your sheet, so what does the word, what do you think of when you see the word apologetics?
Apologizing.
Apologizing, which means saying you're sorry. That is one sense of the word apology, and that is the way we most commonly use it today. The word apology, as it comes from its Latin roots. Latin roots. Where's my water bottle? Actually has to do, making an apology in the sense that we're talking about here, is to make some statement about what we believe. So when we talk about apologetics, it's making statements about what our faith teaches us. Not to say to somebody who objects to us being Catholic, to say, oh, you know, I'm sorry if that bothers you. That's not, that is the way we use apology in our English language. Mm-hmm. When we say apologetics, it's how, basically, how do we defend our faith? And I said somebody last time for a topic, tell us how to defend your faith. That's what apologetics is all about. So, and this is going to be a bigger and bigger topic in Catholicism. Here's this book, How to Do Apologetics. And this book, How to Defend the Faith. And there's whole Catholic groups built around apologetics now. But it isn't just, when I say defend the faith, it's not to stand up there and be righteous and prove you're right. We are, at least to the extent we follow what God wants. But we're human, we're not all perfect. But apologetics accomplishes this task by offering those who will listen rational explanations and defense of the truth. Rational. If you read the how to do apologetic book, it talks about using logic and reason and things to show them stuff. Rational explanations in defense of the truth. The highest and the most important of all is the truth that God exists. He loves you and wants you to be happy. It doesn't start with saying the church says this about abortion or this about end of life or immigration or whatever. It starts with even just helping people to understand that God does exist and that He is a God who loves us and is interested in our happiness. God does not exist just to make us happy for us to get our own will. Remember, in the Lord's Prayer, it's thy will be done, not my will be done. But, it's just offering arguments for that. And then, in the same book, referring to his own book, Madrid says, the goal of this book is not so much to prove the truth of Catholic teaching, but to show how we can use biblical, historical, logical to demonstrate that effectively that Catholic teaching is reasonable, consistent, and compelling. some people just don't think it's reasonable. Why would you believe that? Why would you believe in a God? You know? Or consistent? Well, sometimes that's where we need to grow in our own knowledge so we can make sure we understand why we believe stuff and compel it. And there's real reason. But in the end, apologetics is not about winning the argument to convince him of the faith. See right here? You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. We can offer it to people, but we're not to hound them with them. We're not, everybody's not necessarily going to believe. If they do, let me know how you do that.
Plant a seed.
But yeah, plant seeds. Do things. And if it's somebody you see, you know, if it's your neighbor and you see them over and over again, you don't have to convert them in the first conversation. that you'll see them again, at least if you're a nice neighbor. You see them again. After they've lived there a week, if they start putting up a 10-foot high fence, it may present a different challenge to it. Other thoughts? And the whole apologetics and how to, as I said, there's several books on it. Maybe down the road we can talk about it more. The word we talked about perspective before. In the book, without apologetics, you don't even know who we're talking about. And they use the term natural apologetics. And here's like, if you're starting with somebody who has absolutely no sense of God, you got to meet them where they're at. So with natural apologetics, you just use logic and reason, and the book gives more details about this, to even help them to believe that a God exists, period. Then you start getting into particular Christian arguments. And this isn't all linear. It tells me that first conversation, it doesn't mean you can't talk about Jesus. But you can't necessarily expect him to make the loop all at once. Then there's what we'll say Christian apologetics. If you got somebody who believes in God but who isn't necessarily a Christian, take that common belief that there even is a God and then work towards saying why you believe in the Christian God. And again, I said, why do you believe that way? And then Catholicism versus other Christian. Another quote from Paul VI in that Evangelii document. Evangelization loses much of its force and effectiveness if we do not take into consideration the actual people to whom it addresses, if it does not use their language, their signs and symbols, if it does not answer the questions they ask, or if it does not have an impact on their lives. And we say language here, you know, language in a very little sense, you know, English versus Spanish or something, if you're going to a foreign land, so to speak, that's very literal language. And signs and symbols, different cultures use signs and symbols differently. But even now, with such a diverse population as we are in our country, trying to think of an example, my mind's drawing a blank. A sign that means one thing for us doesn't necessarily mean the same thing for another. I mean, you know, in Christianity, you look at a cross, any Christian you talk to is going to have say, oh, that's a cross. But if they have no experience of Jesus, you hold that up and it's like, why are you holding up a stick of wood that looks like a letter T? You know, and that is not a very good example. But what can be a basic symbol for us doesn't mean. Or, you know, I think even, like, we don't know what God the Father looks like. But if someone paints a picture, generally it tends to be, in the past, a white-haired old man, because of old, wise, distinguished. So if you're talking in a religious connotation at all in a Judeo-Christian society, and you do that image, and you show them that image, they might say, oh, you're talking about God the Father. If they have no experience of faith, it's an old man. Yeah, what do you want? So to understand, when you're talking to your neighbor, whoever it is, you got to find out first where they are at. Even if you have reason to believe they're Catholic, say, don't assume they know A, B, and C. It could be somebody like me who was brought up Catholic, but weak Catholic at best, and didn't know all the stuff I should have known basic. stuff. And they have to find out where they're at first, and that before you get into detailed discussions. And again, that doesn't mean you don't talk about Jesus right away, but if they say, who's Jesus? Then say, oh, wait a minute, we got to back up. Let's get to a common ground and build from there. Go and Make Disciples is a document the United States bishops wrote in, I believe, the 1990s. It might have been 1992. They came in it, they talk a lot about this idea of going out and sharing the faith. And they had three goals in mind with the document. Goal one, to bring about in all Catholics such an enthusiasm for their faith that living their faith in Jesus, they freely share it with others. How can we all get so on fire with our faith that, you know, right now for us, it may seem to take, we got to figure out, okay, how do we get started talking about our faith? Ideally, if we evangelize ourselves, we get so excited that we'll be sharing our faith in the way we live without even doing the explicit. Okay. Doesn't mean we still have to do the explicit words, but just the best way to be an evangelizing Catholic is to be a good Catholic. So just learn about your faith and live it. And then someone says to you, why are you so nice? Oh, let me tell you. You're laughing, Anna. Doesn't anybody say to you, you're so nice, why? The second goal of the three, to invite all people in the United States, wherever their social cultural background, to hear the message of salvation, Jesus Christ, so they may come to join us. Evangelize ourselves so that we share faith with others. Then goal three actually says, to foster gospel values in our society. We often talk about evangelization and sharing our faith as something we might do with people. Again, if you think about society as a whole, our country was founded on Judeo-Christian practices. Sometimes that's a little hard to see today. So as much as we need to evangelize individuals, we need to be talking about our values in public. That can be all the more an intimidating thing that you do, because that's where we can get, the ACLU steps in and says, when we can't sit, or people accuse us of hate speech and that. But not to force it down people, but just be willing to share what we believe. That other people can talk about why they believe and they don't agree with us. How come we can't? But this can be a very challenging thing. And this can be one where we need to learn a lot more ourselves to be able to do this. Sometimes we know, but lots of people know the Catholic Church objects to abortion. People don't really know the argument behind it a lot of times. So, this quote comes from the Synod on the New Evangelization in Rome a few years ago. Transmitting the faith. When we think about giving the faith, again, I mean, think about the catechism again. Transmitting the faith isn't a matter of saying, oh, here's this book, read it. Here's what the church teaches, A, B, and C. That's an important step. But it begins by helping them have a personal encounter with Jesus. That personal encounter can be you. Because as Paul Wallace is quoted in one of these books, Forming Intentional Disciples, he said, I am not a Christian because it makes sense. It does. Or because someone sat down and diagrammed it for me and said, here's all the reasons. I am a Christian because I have been loved deeply and unconditionally by Christians. Sometimes the best way we can show the faith is to show we love and care. Comments?
Who's Paul Wallace? I'm sorry, I don't know.
I don't either. Oh. It was a quote in the book. based on the quote and things, he's somebody who blogs about his Catholic faith. And this is a quote from something. And the way it reads and the way it outlined it, I'm assuming he's a convert to the faith. And then he's talking about what got him to come to the faith. If you read lots of lives on the internet, he's probably somebody you might be familiar with. But I don't know about you. I have enough trouble finding time to write on my own blog, let alone go read somebody else. And for those of you, if you don't know what the word blog means, if you don't own a computer, don't worry about it. So, to evangelize others, we can talk about first evangelizing ourselves. So create an enthusiasm within us. Give us the excitement about our faith. And sometimes it means, and this can apply to evangelism too. Some people say, you know, they don't come to church a lot because they don't feel like they get much out of it because they don't understand. To work to understand more ourselves so that we in turn can show that excitement to others. So we need, when we don't understand or we don't feel like we get much out of it, ask questions. We can read the Bible. If you don't have a Bible, I still have some. Other spiritual books. We can just pray to God for God to help us to know the Holy Spirit. Attend adult faith learning opportunities. I think there's some that happen around here. But always work to be open. This is Rivers in the book, Maintenance and Mission. I believe that God has made us with a powerful desire for truth, but also with a capacity for self-delusion. And sometimes we think we know the answers and our answers are so we need to have our eyes open constantly. And going back to God, help me to always look at things about our faith with open eyes, to see more, to realize there's more going on, and to realize it is a lifelong process. Learning about our faith, of course you're here tonight so you know this, does not end at confirmation. Anybody who says they know what they need to know when they're confirmed is wrong. You're only beginning to know. Hopefully when you were confirmed, you knew a lot of stuff about your faith. I would say I didn't know enough when I was confirmed. But it doesn't stop at confirmation. Like I can say, you all know that or you wouldn't be here. A couple Sundays ago, we talked about the Samaritan woman. In the homily, I talked about how she didn't know a whole lot about Jesus. But as soon as she started thinking, oh, could he be the Christ? She went and started telling other people. Okay, sharing what experience she had with Jesus. Not a great amount of experience, but a powerful experience. So, this quote is from the Forming Intentional Disciples book. So when it says RCI director, it's not Lee. well, of course, I'm assuming it's not. Maybe it is. One very effective RCA director summed up her mission this way. My job is in the inquiry period. And the inquiry period, for those who don't know, is the very beginnings when they're first coming and saying, hey, I'm interested. But they haven't made necessarily a commitment to do that. To help people fall in love with Jesus. My job in the catechumenate, which is what comes after they make the rite of acceptance, is to help people fall in love with the church. But just first give them an encounter with Jesus. Give them an experience that says, yeah, this is the type of thing I'm looking for. You know, not to force knowledge on them. But, you know, if you wonder why your children don't come to church, talk about the relationship they have with Jesus, or what don't they get out of it versus, you know, just saying, well, you got to go to church. That's what the rule says. So how do we evangelize other people? Which is really the point of tonight. So it's about encounter as much more than knowledge. The knowledge is important. We get them started with a relationship with Jesus. Then we all got to work to know more knowledge. But it starts there. St. Francis said, preach the gospel, always use words only when necessary. Living the faith, being loving, giving them warm experiences. go back to what I said. I said, you know, you got to think about your own relationship with Jesus and then share that with others. Be welcoming and friendly, not judgmental. When you're trying to evangelize somebody because they're doing something wrong, the correct way to start is not going up to them and saying, that's wrong. you're going to burn in hell if you don't do that. But to start a conversation with them. Now that, we'll talk, there's this quote later, about sometimes we got to tell them what they're doing is, we want to tell them it's wrong in some way, but not to begin by just saying it's wrong. Medicine of mercy is a term from, I think it's John the 23rd, Pope John the 23rd, to bring them in by showing them mercy and compassion, helping them in their needs. Practice what you preach. If you tell somebody something is wrong and then you go do it yourself, you don't speak with a whole lot of credibility. But then some people will say, well, who are you to talk? You don't live this much better. You know, sometimes it can be helpful admitting our own weaknesses to say, hey, this is what I'm trying to live. I know I don't always do it. It doesn't mean I'm not trying. So it's not always helpful to admit our weaknesses, but sometimes it can be the thing that brings people in. Because then you talk about forgiveness and contrition, repentance.
A lot of people sometimes, they hear about or talk to us. It's along that line because they're so judgmental. Some Christians are, mm-hmm. don't show mercy, don't understand, and that's why they left.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, people go away from the faith because of people being judgmental. Other famine. Sometimes it's as simple, and I tend to say this, like leading up to Christmas, I'll tell people, you know, when you're making your Christmas plans and you're making things, and somebody says, oh, let's do our gathering Christmas Eve at 4 o'clock. To say, if you go to the 4 o'clock mass, say, I'm going to be at church then. Show it's important to you to choose church. Because if they know, you go to church once in a while, but if they say, oh, let's have the family party at 6, and you're supposed to be at church at 6, and you say, okay, and you miss church, they say, oh, I thought church was so important to you. So you said you just got to be willing to choose church and do what they let them do what they do. I tell my family, don't expect to see me on Christmas. I say a whole bunch of masses, then I go home and take a 3-hour nap. And sometimes it can be as simple, depending, and this isn't necessarily, you have to think about the book you read. But if you read a book or take a CD from upstairs, you like it, or you get some DVD about the faith, and you think somebody else could benefit from it, share it with them. When you're done with it, give it to them. Again, meeting them where they're at in some way. Don't give them Thomas Aquinas if they're still trying to figure out who God is, period. But to be sharing, if you see there, something you read that you think pertains to a certain person, give it to them. If they don't read it, what's the loss? If they do, there'd be a lot to gain. And with this, you know, I talked about evangelization ourselves, I talked about reading and whatnot. Dialogue is a form of evangelization. Sometimes it's just having conversations with people that aren't even meant necessarily to convert them. Just to have a conversation with it. And sometimes we can say, I don't even know where to begin. Jesus is important to me, but I don't know how to talk about it. Well, sometimes the dialogue for us to be able to evangelize other people outside the church or who have never been in the church or have fallen away from the church, the dialogue has to start with us who are already going to church dialoguing with each other. And this is where we can talk about small Christian communities. It's small groups of people getting together. We have at least two or three groups I know of in the parish that are organized as small. Some will do it as Bible studies. Some will read a book together. Some people in the parish are involved in Crusade. There's grouping that goes with that. It uses a little bit different process. But some way of coming together and talking about our faith. Often they do involve books, whether it's the Bible or a different book about faith, to talk about it. But sometimes before we can go talk to people outside our church, we need to just start talking with people ourselves, who when we try and say something have some sense of what we're trying to talk about. And then we find the words that we can then go use with somebody else. Right? Because we got to start someplace, and sometimes the safest place to start is with other people. And sometimes these small Christian communities can be things that are long enduring. The people really support each other. It's not doesn't have to be just about reading a chapter in a book a week or something. It be saying, "Hey, I had a bad week. This is why." To share that. So even starting with that dialogue within the church to hopefully then go beyond. Question? Paul, when you look at Paul's evangelism, going out in Acts of the Apostles, when Paul went out on his missions, the letters he wrote, he didn't just go out and evangelize individuals in different towns. He worked to evangelize whole communities. And when he left a town, he tried to leave a structure in place, which could be making something between a small Christian community and a parish type setting, for them to support each other. And when you think about going out on the road, so to speak, wherever Paul went, somebody was always going with him, supporting each other. So you don't have to... Now, when you're talking to your neighbor, you probably don't want to bring the next person that's a total stranger with you and say, "Oh, let's talk about our faith today." But to have somebody you can bounce ideas off yourself, it doesn't literally mean going door to door together. You could. And I mentioned before when I talked about the forming intentional disciples in the homily a few weeks ago. You all remember that, right? So, what I talked about was five thresholds, in the sense of meeting people where they're at. Again, we can't assume they're all fully ready to embrace Jesus. Sometimes we can invent people that we find are a lot more open than we think they might be. But sometimes we just gotta even to start, and this is where it could be you evangelizing versus me. You know some of these people, you know, if they're your neighbor, they're your family, they have some reason to believe what you say. They may not be keen on faith, but they know you in some way. And they're willing to give you a chance to say something. So there's just, they're willing, somebody, this initial trust is initial trust. They're willing to give you a chance to say something. They think you're an intelligent person with something to offer. Sometimes that's all they're ever at in terms of faith. Sometimes they'll go a little further. So, second threshold, spiritual curiosity. You've said something, you've caught their attention. Oh, tell me a little bit more about that. Not deep embracing, this isn't the point when you go grab the catechism, or maybe not even the Bible. Yeah, you just start and let them ask questions, or just, you know, it might just be, they say, "Oh, that's interesting. Tell me more." Just whatever you were talking about, just tell them more. It's not making huge strides necessarily. Sometimes it's baby steps. Third one, openness. They're starting to say, "Hey, you got something going here. Maybe I want to listen. Maybe I should think about changing in some ways what I do." They're not necessarily doing it yet, but they're thinking about it. And then spiritual seeking. They're starting to make some real changes in their lives. They're asking deliberate questions. They're trying to grow. They're trying to live what Jesus teaches us. And then the fifth one is truly choosing to be a disciple. And when she's describing all these thresholds in her book, Wendell says, even most people who are in the pews every week, many of them she would have put in levels 3 or 4. Not too many at level 5. So again, just because somebody's in church every week, don't say, "Oh, good, they're disciples." Well, maybe they want to be in some ways, but they haven't got there. And this includes us. You know, we could be the most active people in the church, but how much are we going through motions versus how much are we really there? Questions? but it's hard. Luke 12, I'm not going to read this whole quote because it's long. And, this is the one, though, where he says, you think I've come to cause peace? No, division. Because of me, father against son, mother against daughter. Jesus does say at one point in Matthew's gospel, my yoke is easy, my burden light. He doesn't say there is no yoke, there is no burden. He says it's easy, light. Those are relative terms. Life is better with Jesus than without. But sometimes it can mean hard choices. Going back to the Acts of Apostles, they at times, those the early apostles were persecuted. You know, of the 12 apostles, only one was not martyred. Some were martyred shortly after Jesus, some lived a number of years. But 11 of the 12 apostles were martyred. They didn't have to have a pension plan. But to think it's all going to be easy. Now, we're not likely to be martyred today in our country, but we can face great difficulties talking about our faith. But if the apostles had to work to spread the faith to the disciples, where would we be? We can encounter people who have had bad experiences with the church. The most public one today might be sometimes the sex abuse scandal. You know, if the church has truly wronged somebody, and wronging somebody is not letting them, not saying their family member's funeral can't be at 10 o'clock, it's got to be at 11 o'clock. That is not the church wronging somebody. But like with the sex abuse scandal, it's okay to say to them, if someone actually says to you they're a victim of abuse by a priest, that never should have happened. To say to them that is wrong is okay. We don't have to excuse away what the church did. It should not have happened. Period. So with that, to be willing to apologize for the things. Now, before you rush to apologize or rush to validate, make sure there's something that really is. Sex abuse scandal, no question, is something that never should have happened. So don't apologize without knowing what the issue is. But you know, beyond them, you could say, I'm sorry, when I talk about church, I see you're hurt. I'm sorry if you've had a bad experience. But be willing to talk about it. The church has screwed up at times. It happens when you involve human beings. But then invite them to say, yeah, you know, the church used to cover up sex abuse things. Now, if the diocese gets a call that seems at all credible, they call the DAs, and the diocese calls the DA if the person had it. Because it is wrong, it should not happen. And when I say credible at all, I mean, the threshold is, I've heard of cases getting called in where they say, priest Bob Smith abused me in this at St. Joe's on this day. Well, there never was a Bob Smith anywhere near that parish, anywhere near that time. So, and even then they try and find out, did they just mess up the name or something? But there, unfortunately, there are people who have made false claims. But if there's any credibility at all, our diocese, many other dioceses, call the police, let the police do the investigation. Especially if it's something that they're seeing happening today. Then they absolutely call the police if it's a current thing. So don't be afraid to apologize if the church has done something wrong. Final thoughts? Everybody awake? All right. Here's that quote from Matthew's Gospel. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is our mission. This is what Jesus tells us to do. Each in our own way. And when I say each in our own way, I'm the pastor. It said, canon law says the priest is to make every effort with the help of the Christian faithful. That's you people. To bring the gospel message to those who have ceased practicing their religion or who not profess the truth. I may have a typo. Yeah, maybe there's supposed to be a do. I think there's a word missing anyway. The pastor has a particular responsibility, but I can't do it. And here's where the Catechism of the Catholic Church says, lay people can evangelize in ordinary circumstances. Now going back to those five thresholds, and the first one being trust, you encounter people, you have a relationship, some close, some distant, you barely know them, but you're interacting with these people in a way I can't. So you have a different credibility with them. It doesn't mean you have to teach them everything. You get them interested, bring them to Lee for RCA, let her worry about it. And actually, there's a couple other people in the room to help with RCA too. It's not a one-person job, and if they don't know, then they come to me and say, Father, what about this? But you encounter people in ways I can't. But it doesn't mean you have to go out and teach them everything. You help them to develop that curiosity, that seeking. Then we can do more than that. Then we take them to Lee. So. Going back to the idea of you don't start a conversation with somebody by telling them something they're doing is wrong. You try to have a conversation with them. Help them to see the error of their ways, not being judgmental. But here, Martin writes in his book, our unconditional love can never mean doing the one we love the profound disservice of encouraging them in their sin, as painful as it is. That would be like a doctor telling a patient has cancer, they'll be all right, and not tell them the treatment that would actually save their life. Grossman, malpractice, profoundly misguided compassion. You know, if we're young and otherwise healthy, we've got some bad disease, don't we want the doctor to tell us about it? But there's right ways to tell them. Make sense? And this. Yes, last one. Sometimes we think, oh, if I just learn enough, I could be able to talk about my relationship with Jesus, I can go do this. It's not about I or we. The evangelist, however energetic and skillful she or she may be, is powerless to accomplish anything without the grace of God. As St. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. Another typo. You don't know how many times I've looked at these slides, and I don't even know what the words say anymore. One of these days I should learn to have somebody proofread them for something that doesn't make sense. But it's not all about what can I do. It's what is God calling me to do, and then is God going to help? Because it could be, we don't have to know it all itself. I mean, like tonight, to make this a good experience, I hope the cookies and the brownies and things and the coffee are not the sole reason you come. But can they make it for a better evening? Yeah. I didn't make those cookies and brownies and the coffee. I don't even know how to run the coffee pot here because I don't drink this stuff. But we have our Martha's Ministry people tonight. It was Ann and Anna who do that to help us to have good experience. And when you read stuff about doing adult faith events, they say one of the things that's important is food, having refreshments. But I didn't do it all myself. There was other people involved. So. But there's the direct sharing of faith, but there's ways of dot that, you know, those types of things. So we can all help in some way. Questions?